So today, I want to bring you a message from the Word. You remember that before all this crisis happened, we were in a series on the life of Christ. And so I thought, you know, I don't want to just keep talking about COVID-19. Every day I watch the news and it's COVID-19 and COVID-19 and COVID-19. I want to get our minds on heavenly things. I want to get our minds back on the Lord. So I want to get back to that series that we were going through before this all started. And we've been looking at different aspects of the life of Christ. And today I want to talk to you about Jesus, the teacher sent from God. Jesus, the teacher sent from God. And in our last message in this series, we looked at Jesus, the miracle worker. And I used for you John chapter 3, where Jesus, this man named Nicodemus, a Jewish leader, came to him and he said, "Rabbi," which means teacher, "we know you're a teacher sent from God because nobody can do the miracles you do, the signs you do, unless God is with him." So we talked last time about the miracles and how Jesus showed that he was the Son of God by the miracles. But today I want to draw your attention to the other part there of that same verse. He said, "We know you're a teacher sent from God." Okay? And I want to emphasize that the fact that Jesus was a teacher. First of all, remember the little ditty that I keep reminding you of, that I like it to get, you know, engraved in your minds there, printed into the circuits of your brain. When we talk about the life of Christ, I read this years ago when I took a course on the life of Christ. I never forgot it. The professor said, "What does God require of man?" The answer was the life of Christ. In other words, how are we supposed to live? Like Jesus lived. That's what God requires. Be ye perfect as your Father in heaven is perfect. God requires the life of Christ. But we fall short. So the second part of the phrase is, what has God provided for man? And the answer is the same. The life of Christ. Because we fall short, God sent his Son to work in our behalf, to teach us how to live, and then to die for our sins so that we could have his righteousness attributed to us by faith, so that we could be saved by his grace. Amen? What does God require of man? The life of Christ. What has God provided for man? The life of Christ. And so, one very important aspect of that life was the teaching of Christ, how he taught us. So I want to look at the significance of Jesus coming as a teacher. There's no doubt this is one of his primary roles on earth. He's called teacher many times in the scripture. They would always say, "Teacher, the one who you loved is sick. Teacher," the people are saying this, "teacher that." And so he was often called teacher or rabbi. And rabbi means my master, but it also means teacher. Today I was reading John 20 where Jesus appeared to Mary Magdalene. And she said she thought he was the gardener. And she said, "They've taken away my Lord. If you know where he is, please tell me and I'll go get him myself." Can you imagine this little lady carrying a full-grown man? She was going to do it. She didn't know it was Jesus himself. It wasn't the gardener. And he said, "Mary." He called her by name. And all of a sudden she understood it was him. And she said, "Rabboni." Or actually it's Rabbani. And it means teacher. In one version I read today, she called him, it said that, she called him teacher. And so that's what he was called. He was an expert in God's word, in God's ways, God's laws. Why is it important to see Jesus as a teacher? Well, because his primary mission, of course, was not just teaching. His primary mission on earth was to die for our sins. But he also came to establish a church. And the church had to carry on. We have to carry on his mission, right, in the world. And so that required that Jesus came to teach people the way of God by word and example. He's both the way to God and the way of God par excellence. You ever think about this? When God called Israel out of Egypt, he called them to Mount Sinai. And what did he give them there? He gave them the Torah. Torah means law, but it also means instruction. So when God called people to be with him, the first thing he did was to teach them how to be his people. So when his son came to launch a new people of God and a new dispensation, he obviously had to teach us. Because if he'd have just come and died for our sins without teaching us, we wouldn't have understood what that death was even about or for. We wouldn't have understood how to receive the benefit of his death, right? So through his teaching, he caused people to understand who he was and who God was and what God wanted so that they could come back to God. He called the Jewish people to be with him, to be his people. And they got astray from that. As so many, as we do, we wander off, we lose perspective, we lose our vision of the path. And so Jesus had to come and call them back to that relationship. And to do that, he had to teach who God even was, teach what God wanted his people to know and do and be. I love to think about how Jesus went about getting his message across. You know, there's never been a teacher like him. One way in which he taught was through miracles. And the miracles were like a live demonstration of what he was teaching. Like, for example, remember when four men brought a paralytic to him and they tore up the roof and lowered him down, lowered the paralytic down in front of Jesus. And then Jesus took that occasion to say to the man, "Son, your sins are forgiven." And so then the people said, "This is blasphemy. Who can forgive sins but God alone?" And then he said, "So that you may know that I have authority on earth to forgive sins," he spoke to the paralytic and said, "Rise, take up your bed and walk." So he taught by a miracle. By the miracle, he showed that he was sent from God and he had authority to heal, but also to forgive sins. He taught through a miracle. On another occasion, a leper came to him and said, "Lord, if you're willing, you can make me clean." And so Jesus said, "I am willing. Be clean." And he touched him and the guy was healed. He was cleansed. So Jesus did a miracle to show that the will of God is our well-being, our healing, our restoration, that he does care about us when we're sick. And he said, "I am willing, be healed." So he taught through a miracle. And so many miracles are like that. They teach you a lesson. Like when Peter walked on the water, obviously that was a lesson to Peter because he was doubting and so forth and he sank. But it's a lesson to everybody ever since, because we all learn, you know, that when you look at the wind and the waves, you sink. And so you got to keep your eyes on Jesus. And I think we also learn, to me, it's a picture of like living the Christian life and overcoming sin. You know, it's hard to overcome sin. It's like walking on the water and you get your eyes off Jesus. You sink and you fail. But Jesus says, "Why did you doubt?" And he raises him up. See, that's a lesson to me. The miracle is also a teaching. He can enable you to live the Christian life. Like, you know, I was a druggie and everything, and God, and, you know, drug addicts, they don't give up their drugs, but God helped me, and he did it, and he helps people overcome their sin, and they can walk on the water, so to speak. When he turned water into wine, that was a miracle, that it met the need of the people there at the wedding. They needed wine, but it also showed how Jesus can change the very nature of something. Isn't that beautiful? I mean, he can turn ordinary water into the best wine. And he can turn an ordinary sinner into a saint. He can change your heart. He can change the very nature of things. So Jesus taught through miracles. He also taught in a lot of different venues, a lot of different settings. Sometimes he spoke to thousands of people. Can you imagine? He must have had a powerful voice. They didn't have all this stuff we got today. He could speak in a loud voice. He sat in a boat on the shore, and there were hundreds or thousands of people there, and he spoke to them. Other times he spoke to just the 12 disciples, or to three or four people. One time, we have a lesson he gave to one man, a guy named Nicodemus, chapter 3, that we use for text today. Nicodemus came, and Jesus gave him the most important verse that's ever been spoken, John 3:16. It seems that he was just teaching one man. By the way, I gotta tell you a little story. Years ago, I was down in Mexico teaching a mission school, and the guy who directs it, he used to travel out from his little center there and go a couple hours away, and he would minister to different people and also buy things at stores and stuff like that he needed. So he said, would you go with me? There's this one Tarahumara Indian, and I've been ministering to him. Would you give him a little lesson? I said, sure. So we rode along. It's like an hour and a half out there, and we did different things. And then we came to this Indian's house. It's Tarahumara Indian. They're the ones, by the way, who run 90 miles. They can run, like, they wear these huarache sandals that are made out of tires. And some of them that are in shape are famous for, like, running up to 90 miles in these marathon things. But anyway, I'm teaching this guy. He wasn't one of those runners. He was older by this time. And so I got one person. I'm teaching one person. And I'm going at it. And, of course, the guy who invited me is there with me. But, you know, I'm not teaching him. And I'm going through my teaching. And the guy there, the Indian guy, he goes to sleep. Now, I'm used to people going to sleep when I preach in a church. Sometimes there's some folks who go to sleep. My dad always used to sleep in church. He couldn't help it. He'd go to sleep. So I'm used to a few people sleeping, but when it's your whole congregation and they go to sleep, what do? I kind of didn't know, you know, should I keep going or what? I just kind of looked at my buddy there and we smiled, you know, and I just cut the teaching. Go ahead, you can stop it. Jesus gave one of his best teachings ever to just one guy, you know. He taught different groups. As I say, he taught in different venues, like, you know, in the boat on the Sea of Galilee. By the way, when you go to Israel, they found a boat back a few years ago. It's from that time, and they preserved it, they brought it in, and it's in a museum. You can see the boat. You see about how big it was and everything. It's amazing. The Jesus boat, they call it. So he sat in the boat and he taught, He taught the Sermon on the Mount, you know, either, as Luke says, in a plain near a mountain, a hill, or up actually on the hill itself. He taught in an olive grove. He taught at the temple. He taught in homes, in synagogues, and out in the street. And he used all kind of methods to teach as well. That's another amazing thing about Jesus. There's never, never been a better teacher than Jesus. Like, you know, he taught by parables. Nobody's ever taught like that. I mean, boy, I wish I could think of stories like he thought of when I would teach it. It makes it so much more interesting, and you never forget it. You never forget it. Like, did you ever know about the Good Samaritan, that story? There's a whole background to it that you don't know if you haven't been able to study. But, like, there's this guy, and he says to him, well, who's my neighbor? And so instead of, you know, somebody like me, I would say, well, your neighbor is A, B, C, letter one, number one, number two. I would just explain. Jesus didn't do that. Instead, he tells a story. There was this guy, and he was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho. It's down the hill, you know, it's downhill for miles, 10, 15 miles. So he's going down there, and there's cliffs and stuff around there, and it's kind of remote. And so he's robbed, and he's beaten up by these people. And he was a Samaritan. And Samaritans, that's the N-word to Jews. I don't want to be crude, but that was the N-word to them. They were racist. They hated Samaritans. They looked at them as half-breeds. They weren't pure in their race. They weren't pure in their religion. They were mixed up. Everything about them was wrong. And if you called somebody a Samaritan, it was like the N-word. They're the worst of people. Those people, they're no good. They're dirty, you know? And so this guy, I said he was a Samaritan. He wasn't. No, he was a Jew. But he was going down to Jericho, and these people beat him up and robbed him. And he's really injured, and he's lying there bleeding and hurting. And a priest came by, a guy like me, who's a religious leader. And he just passed by on the other side. He didn't help him at all. And then a Levite, who's another religious type, he comes by and he passes by. He doesn't want to touch the guy. He's beat up. I don't want to be involved. Remember back in the 80s when people were raped and killed and all, and the crowds around him said, I didn't want to get involved, so they didn't help. It's that kind of thing. And then Jesus says, but this Samaritan came along. And when you hear the story, if you're a Jew, the priest and the Levite, they're the top of the line. They're the best. So they're the good guys. They're holy people. But they didn't do what was right. They didn't help. They didn't care about this guy, but
But they're like, you know, the upper class, the upper crust. And they didn't do anything. And then Jesus says the Samaritan came along. And for the people that were listening to him, see, we don't know what that means. It doesn't register with us. But for the people that were listening to him, it's like saying, and then this dirtbag came along. This N-word came along. This biker, this homosexual, this terrible person that you would say was a scum of the earth. You would say he's scum. He came by. And he saw the guy and he grabbed him and he lifted him up. He put oil and wine on his wounds and he cared for him. And he put him on his donkey and he took him to a hotel and he cared for him. And then he paid the innkeeper to keep him. And he said, if it costs you any more, I'll pay you back when I get back through here. We don't realize how impactful that was. But when you said the Samaritan did it, it was like the atheist did it. The scum did it. The trailer trash did the right thing. And you were shocked. And you were kind of almost resentful, almost angry. How dare he say a story like that? That's terrible. See, we don't realize, we don't appreciate the fullness. Jesus told stories that just you never forgot. And ever since that time, how many preachers have preached about the Good Samaritan? And how many people, even that don't go to church, know the story of the Good Samaritan? Why? Because when Jesus taught something, buddy, you got it. It came into your heart and you never forgot. Remember when he was eating with this one religious Pharisee who invited him to dinner? And then this woman who was a hooker in the town, or at least she slept around. She came into the home there where this dinner party was going on, and the rabbi was there at the table. And she came up and started weeping over his feet and washing them with her tears and wiping them with her hair. And the Pharisee thought, this woman, she's a slut. She's come here. If this guy was really a prophet, he'd know what kind of woman this is. She shouldn't even be touching him. We should run her out. And so Jesus, he doesn't tell us a teaching or give a theological dissertation. He says, hey, Simon, I got something to say to you. And he goes, sure. Okay, so we're going to continue here. I was preaching outside in the blazing sun. And it was Sunday. Now it's Monday. The video was cut off, as you notice. And so I have to finish the rest of the message inside here today. And there's a tremendous rainstorm outside with lightning flashing and booms going off as transformers blow up around me. So if the power goes off, we'll have a problem. But let's continue the message here. I want you to hear this. You know I got to be fanatical about this for me to do it and preach to a quiet room, an empty room, just a camera. But I want to continue this message about Jesus as the greatest teacher. And I was talking about how he used different formats, he used different forms, literary forms. He used stories that were just amazing. He used parables, comparing this with this. You know, you tell a story of something and the parts of it correspond with some spiritual truth. That's what a parable is. He used similes and metaphors. He used hyperbole, where you overstate things and say, unless you hate your parents and hate your own life, you can't be my disciple. He used those kinds of things to get people's attention in ways that have never, ever been equaled by anyone. He taught by words, as in with sermons and lectures and stuff, especially to his disciples. But he also taught by example and by practice, by demonstration. He showed his disciples. But then he also had them practice what he'd shown. This is what's so amazing. He didn't just lecture. He trained, and there's quite a difference, because a lecture, you're not accountable for. You just, you know, you got a test maybe, and you're accountable in that way. But you listen to a lecture, and if you want to, you know, catch on to everything, fine. If you don't, fine. But what Jesus did was he taught you how to be something, how to do something, and then he gave you an assignment so that you would put it into practice. You know, like, take, for example, running a cash register or a computer or any job you have to do, operating a machine or something. Would it be enough to just give a lecture to somebody? No. You just won't learn. Like, could you give lectures on basketball or lectures on teaching without ever getting into lectures, on swimming,
without ever having students get into the pool or without ever having them practice basketball on the court. You can't learn that way. And so the Christian life is not just information, but transformation. Jesus taught in such a way that he then put his disciples into situations where they would practice what he taught them. His method was this. I really like this. He would say, I do and you watch. Then he would say, I do and you help. I'll give you assignments. You help me do what I'm doing. But then it would progress. And he would say, you do and I'll help. And then finally it got to the place where he said, you go out and do and then come back to me and report, and we'll do an after action thing, and we'll talk about it, and we'll help you learn what went wrong and what went right and all that kind of stuff afterwards. And so he was a master teacher and a master discipler. He trained people, and he did a good job, because let me tell you, the church has been going ever since, over 2,000 years. Those early disciples were able to carry the ball down the field and across the line, so to speak. Now, there are many aspects of Jesus' teaching that are special, unique, or extraordinary. Let me mention a few. Number one was, he taught with authority. Mark 1:22 says one of the first things people noticed when Jesus taught in the beginning of his ministry was that he taught with authority, not as the scribes and Pharisees. See, what that means is the scribes and Pharisees were just religious teachers like the common ones we have today, who just kind of repeat everything by rote. They just go drone on in monotones and tell you things that others have said. And it's not what they're teaching. It's not from them. It's from somebody else. And that's what I do. I teach what other people have said. I teach what Jesus said, and so on. But when Jesus taught, he taught with authority. In other words, he said, what I'm saying to you is absolutely something you have to believe and obey. It's like in the Old Testament, again, when God called his people to himself on Mount Sinai, he would give them laws and regulations, and then he would say, I am the Lord. I'm the Lord. And that's why you got to do these things, because I'm the Lord. That's how Jesus taught. He's the Lord. And he taught truths of God that were absolute and had to do with how you lived your life. And he was able to say things like this. Like, he would say, you've heard it said. In other words, you've heard tradition and teaching from other people that said this, Moses said this, Rabbi said that, but I say to you. And so by doing that, he brought a new level of authority, the authority of God. And he said in places like John 7:16, that his teaching was not his own, it came from God. And so that was the basis of his authority. He was God's spokesperson. Hebrews 1 tells us God in the past spoke to us in many ways and through various prophets. But in these last days, he has spoken to us by his Son. And so the final word with authority comes through Jesus. Now, Jesus, of course, also taught with great wisdom, greater wisdom than anybody has ever experienced. He started expressing that and manifesting that when he was 12 years old, and he was in the midst of the doctors of the law and so forth, and interacting with them in the temple. They amazed him. But even those later in his ministry who opposed him recognized his incredible wisdom. There's cases where the Pharisees and Herodians and the Sadducees all lined up basically to come and attack him. And one after another, they hit him with these what they thought would be difficult questions and arguments to expose him, to show the fallacies of his teachings, or to get him in trouble with the authorities. And Jesus was so incredibly wise that he defeated every one of those attacks. And actually turned them on their head, to where the people attacking him walked away with their tails between their legs. You know, like when they tried to get him on taxes, is it right to pay taxes to Caesar? They wanted to get him in trouble with the authorities. He comes back and says, show me a coin that you pay tax with. Okay, whose image is on this? Caesar's, huh? Well, render unto Caesar that which is Caesar's, and unto God that which is God's. And they were dumbfounded. They couldn't answer. And so he taught with this incredible wisdom. And he defeated them, and nobody could stand up to the wisdom. One time they sent the temple guard to arrest him, remember? And they came back empty-handed. They didn't arrest him, and the leader said, where is he? How come you didn't get him? And they said, nobody ever spoke like this man. And so, you know, that's John 7:46. No man ever spoke like this man. So even those who went out to arrest him, they couldn't believe the wisdom with which he spoke, and they just didn't do it. Another thing about Jesus that was different is that he was very radical in his teaching. Now today when we use the word radical, we think of like Lenin or, you know, some Antifa people, radical people who are revolutionary and so forth. But radical comes from a Latin word, and it just really means going to the root. So Jesus was radical in that sense. He went to the root of things. He called for radical commitment, radical change, radical obedience. He said a lot of things that to this day we can't really understand very well. We wrestle with them and we try to interpret them. There are whole books written, like I have a couple books on my shelves called things like The Hard Sayings of Jesus, because his statements were very radical, very difficult to really get hold of. They were like nothing anybody had ever said before. Like he said, if your eye causes you to stumble, pluck it out. If your hand causes you to sin, cut it off. He said it'd be better for you to be blind, you know, or to not have a hand than to sin. He said you couldn't be his disciple unless you were willing to deny yourself, take up your cross, which is an instrument of torture and death, and follow him. He said you had to hate your own life in this world and hate your mother and your father and things like that. He said if somebody struck you on one cheek, turn the other cheek to him. These are just amazing, radical things that the Lord said. Nobody's ever said anything like them. And people try to explain them away and try to get out from under them, but you can't. The truth is that that these statements are just absolutely unheard of. Let me stop. So can you imagine this? The power, I heard it, lightning crash, and a boom behind me, but someone from the church came to just tell me a tree fell behind us here and hit the power lines. We still have power in this room, but it's amazing. Anyway, returning to the subject, you know, he made a lot of difficult statements, Jesus did, like, you know, turn the other cheek. Things that people say, you know, you can't even do that. Like for example, he said, be ye perfect as your Father in heaven is perfect. Well, who can be perfect? So what did he mean by that? You know, we've wrestled with that for 2,000 years. He said we had to love God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength, and our neighbor as ourselves. So there's no compromise, no lowering of the bar, no installment plan. You either come his way or you don't make it into heaven. Jesus was just very radical. But here's what I want to get to now. If Jesus was the greatest teacher there ever was, and of course, I don't think there's any doubt about that, and if he taught with great authority and great wisdom, and if he brought this radical message, what was the actual essence of his message? What did the great teacher who was sent from God actually teach? This is very important, and the answer isn't as easy to find as you might think. Because, you know, how do you make it concise? I mean, you know, there's a sense in which actually Jesus taught the entire Bible. And by the way, I got to tell you a funny story. Years ago, I was asked to be a character witness in a court trial for a young man that I had, you know, baptized and discipled to some extent, and then he had to go to jail for a crime that he supposedly committed. I don't know if he did or not, but I went there to be a character witness and just say that I'd baptized him and had given him some training. And so the prosecutor said to me, and so Pastor Hoyt, you are a pastor? I said, yes, sir. And what church? I said. And then he said, and so you've interacted with this young man? He said, yeah. I said, yes. He said, then what did you do with him? How did you spend your time with him? I said, well, I taught him things, you know, what the Bible says. And so the guy, you know, attorneys sometimes or prosecutors or whatever, they're not paying attention that much. They're thinking of something else while they're looking at their notes and they're asking you questions. And so he says to me, well, Pastor Hoyt, what does the Bible teach? So here we are in a public courtroom with these people in the court, you know, and I'm a pastor and I'm an evangelist type. And he says, what does the Bible teach? And so I'm like, you know, I'm kind of dumbfounded for a minute, you know, like, should I take advantage of this or what? But fortunately for everybody, before I could come back, you know, think of a good comeback, the other side said, objection, Your Honor, this could become quite involved. And with me especially, because if you ask me what time it is, I'll tell you how to make a watch. But anyway, I didn't have to tell the court there what all the Bible teaches. But this is the kind of dilemma that we face when we think about what did Jesus teach? You know, he taught actually the whole Word of God, because he is the Word of God. He was there when Moses received the Torah and so forth. How do you boil it down? Where's the summary of Jesus' teaching? There's no chapter in the Bible that says, you know, the main points Jesus taught were these, 1, 2, 3, and so on. I mean, we have the Gospels. That's the only place where we actually have Jesus' teaching, right? We understand that in the epistles, the apostles are telling us, kind of interpreting the teachings of Jesus and telling us how to apply them and so forth. But I mean, the only actual place where Jesus teaches is in the Gospels. That's where we have them written down anyway. So if you boil it down, what is the main point of Jesus' teaching? Well, look, this might sound a little bit simplistic, but I believe you really can boil it down to one main thing. The primary thing that Jesus taught was the kingdom of God. That was his message, the kingdom of God. Think about it. When he started his ministry in all the Gospels, early in the early parts of the Gospels, like in Mark 4:17, he said things like this: repent, the kingdom of heaven is at hand. So he said, the time is fulfilled, you know, the time has arrived, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. By the way, some people think there's a difference between the kingdom of heaven and the kingdom of God. I don't. That's the same thing. So he started his ministry saying, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is here. When you know, the text we're using today is John 3, where Nicodemus came to Jesus by night, and he said, we know you're a teacher sent from God. What did Jesus come back with when he spoke to Nicodemus? Well, he said, Nicodemus, no one can ever see the kingdom of God unless he's born again. No one can ever enter the kingdom of God unless he's born from above or born again. So, you know, his answer there was, you know, Nicodemus is saying, we know you're a teacher from God. You might say there that Jesus kind of cut to the chase and said, if I'm a teacher from God, what do I teach? How to enter the kingdom? What the kingdom is like? That kind of thing. It says in Luke 9:60 that when he called the disciples to himself, his first disciples, he called them and equipped them so that what? They might preach the kingdom of God. When they asked him, Lord, teach us to pray, what did he say? The first thing you should do. You start off by saying, hallowed be thy name, honoring and praising God and praying that his name would be honored. But then he said, the next thing you're to pray is, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. That's what he wants you to pray. Just before he left the earth, he commissioned his disciples and he told them what? All authority in heaven and earth has been granted to me. What does that mean? Doesn't that mean Jesus is the king? When he was crucified, Pilate, this is the only one that seemed to get it right, he said, he had the sign put on Jesus' cross, Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews. When Jesus gave the Great Commission and he said, all authority has been given to me and I'm the king, he then said, go into all nations and make disciples, teaching them to obey all things I've commanded. What's that Great Commission really about in its essence? Isn't it a message about the kingdom and saying that the king has come and that Jesus is the king and that you're to go forth and help people understand Jesus as the king and submit to him and become his subjects? You're in the kingdom of Satan because you serve yourself and you serve Satan unwittingly. You need to repent of that and come out of that kingdom into the kingdom of God's dear Son. It's a new day. It's a time in which the kingdom of God has come, and you have a chance to yield to it and surrender to it. In Matthew 24:14, he said, this gospel of the kingdom must be preached in all the world, and then the end of the world will come. So you see, he said the gospel was the gospel of the kingdom. It's interesting that in Acts 17:7, when some troublemakers grabbed some apostles or grabbed some of the Christian believers, they dragged them before the authorities and they said, these men who have turned the world upside down have come here and they're preaching that we should, that there is another king, Jesus. And so that was their complaint, that these guys were saying there's another king, you know, in other words, besides the Emperor Caesar, there's another king. They thought that was insurrection. They didn't understand it's a spiritual kingdom. Jesus, of course, when he was before Pilate, Pilate wanted to see if he's a radical, rabble-rouser, revolutionary that he has to have executed because he's a danger to the Roman Empire. Jesus said, Pilate said, "Are you a king?" Jesus said, "I came for this purpose, to testify to the truth." Pilate said, "What is truth?" But Jesus said, "My kingdom is not of this world. If my kingdom were of this world, my servants would fight, so I wouldn't be turned over to you." But he's definitely a king. And he definitely has a kingdom. Paul the Apostle in Acts 20:25 said that he went around everywhere preaching the kingdom of God. So I hope you can see from this, and we could go on and on. But the main message that Jesus preached, he came to bring us, was a message about the kingdom. Now, there's some important things we need to understand about that kingdom. And the great teacher sent from God, the Lord Jesus, he taught us about the kingdom so that we could understand its nature and so that we could understand what the king is like and who he is and how we should submit to him and how he wants us to live and so forth. And so I want to touch on some of those things. What did the great teacher teach us about the kingdom? Well, one important, very important thing is found in Luke 17, 20 and 21, where he said, "The kingdom of God does not come with observation." In other words, it wasn't going to be a physical kingdom, not in this time period, this dispensation in which we live. He said, but he went on to say, "The kingdom of God is within you, or in your midst, or among you." It can be translated any of those ways. But the gist of that, it seems to me, is he was saying the kingdom is not physical or material. It's not of this time period in which we live, this life. But it's something inward, right? Isn't that the main point? The kingdom is within you. The kingdom is among you or in your midst. It's something inward. And so the kingdom, at least in this time period in which we live, is not visible. It's not physical, but it's inward. It's a kingdom of the heart where people submit themselves to the King, the Lord Jesus, and of course to the Father and the Spirit. It's not a geographical location, but rather it's the place where God rules and reigns and his subjects submit to him and they worship him and they serve him. That is what the kingdom is. Paul said in Romans 14:17, the kingdom of God is not meat nor drink. In other words, physical regulations and things in the outer world, but rather it's righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. So the kingdom is inward. It's a matter of being righteous before God. It's a matter of having the peace of God and the joy of the Holy Spirit. The kingdom is actually where the Spirit rules. Jesus is the king. The Spirit is like the kingdom, right? The Spirit is like the kingdom. When we're in the Spirit, we're in the kingdom. Jesus is our king, and there's righteousness, peace, and joy. It's something within. It's the condition in which we're made righteous. We experience peace and joy in our relationship with God. You might call those the kind of the fruits of the kingdom. Now, look at God obviously rules and reigns in heaven right now, right? God is absolute ruler over the whole universe. There's no doubt of that. But why did he say to us, "Let your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven"? Because for the most part, let's face it, his will is not done here on earth. Now, don't get me wrong. I don't mean in the ultimate sense. He gets done what he wants done. Don't get me wrong. He will always triumph. He gets his will accomplished, right? But you got to admit, there's a lot of stuff that goes on that's not his will. When a baby or child is abused, that's not his will. When people are drunk or drug addicts, or when they steal from one another, or when they're perverse sexually, that's not his will. When they rob folks, when there are dictators who, like Kim Jong-un, who persecute and oppress their own people and cause their lives to be miserable. You can't say that's God's will. God wants Kim Jong-un to do that. God allows it. But my point is, the kingdom of this world, the kingdoms of this world right now, they're not under the rule and reign of the Lord. That's why it says in Revelation, there's a point in Revelation 11 where it says the kingdoms of this world have become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ, and he shall rule and reign forever and ever. See, someday the whole earth will be subjected to the king's rule, right? But it's not under his rule at this point. This world is not yet the kingdom of God. Why? Because people here have themselves as kings, or they serve Satan as king. They serve pleasure, they serve sex, they serve money, they serve power, and they don't serve the Lord. And so that's why when Jesus came on the scene, he said, repent, for now the kingdom of heaven is at hand. In other words, you've been living for yourselves. You've been kings of your own lives, and really without knowing it, you're letting Satan rule over your life. When you are your own ruler, you don't realize that you're playing right into Satan's hand. So Satan's the god of this world, and you've been living for him. Jesus says, repent, renounce that, turn from that, recognize that that's wrong. Stop that way of living and come into my kingdom. Of course, the Bible says in Colossians 1, if you accept Jesus as Lord and ruler, he translates you or transfers you from the kingdom of darkness into his kingdom. And that's Colossians 1:13. And so this is the message of the kingdom. We have to get out of that other kingdom, the kingdom of the world, the kingdom of Satan, the kingdom of self. We have to come under the loving lordship, the loving authority of another king. We come under new management, if you will, when we yield our lives to the Lord Jesus Christ. And so Jesus said, you know, in places like Matthew 15, that out of our heart proceed evil thoughts and murders and adulteries and immoralities and so forth. And so that's the fruit of a heart that's in rebellion toward God. It produces all that. And so when the kingdom comes, your heart is changed. You yield your heart to the Lord. You say, oh Lord, be the Lord of my life. The way we run things is not producing good fruit. The way Satan has run things, if the devil is your shepherd, you shall always want, right? So when the devil is your ruler, when you are your own ruler, life becomes a disaster, becomes a desert, and the fruit that is produced from that is not good fruit. And so that's why we need to come into submission and come into unity and harmony with the true King, the Lord Jesus. He then changes our hearts, just the way he changed water into wine. He makes us from sinners into saints. And that's how what he describes being born again or born from above. So the greatest teacher who ever lived, when he was asked by Nicodemus, when Nicodemus said, we know you're a teacher who's been sent from God, what he said was, you need to be born again or born from above and have a change of heart, which I can give you if you will repent of living for self and yield yourself to me. I'll change you from water into wine. I'll change you into a saint. I'll make you one of my children. I'll adopt you into the family. You'll enter the kingdom as a child. Jesus said, if you don't enter the kingdom as a child, you'll never enter at all. You have to come humbly and submit to him and be born again. So I got to wrap up. But what I'm saying here again, just to review, is just the fact that Jesus is the greatest teacher who ever lived. He is a teacher sent from God. And what he taught us was about his kingdom. He lived that kingdom. He demonstrated that kingdom. And by his death on the cross, he made it possible for every one of us who trust in him and repent and believe to enter that kingdom and live a different life under his authority. Today, folks, he's continuing to teach that message through preachers like me and through all of us, through Christian radio, through books, authors, you know, various ministries all over the world. Jesus continues to teach by his Spirit so that we can come into his kingdom. And folks, the Bible says plainly, the teacher has said that he will one day come back and take control over this earth visibly, physically. And the whole earth will be transformed like water into wine. The whole earth, you think it's beautiful now, nature. You love nature. I love nature. I love the stars and the butterflies and the flowers and the mountains and everything. You think it's beautiful now. He's going to transform it and rule over it lovingly, but with total authority. And all those who have learned this message of the kingdom from the great teacher sent by God, all of us, we'll welcome the King when he comes in the sky. We'll say, Lord Jesus, welcome. We welcome you. We receive you. We're so glad to see you. We love you. Others, however, who have resisted his kingship and his authority, who have constantly bickered and fought and said, we don't want this man to rule over us, how sad and terrible it'll be for them on that day. But folks, we still have time to get ready for the King, to recognize that he's coming, this teacher sent from God, who's also the King. He's taught us what we need to do to be ready. And so I hope that you're praying, Lord, let your kingdom come let your will be done. Teach me your ways. I want to live for you, Lord Jesus. Till next time, I hope that blesses you and edifies you as you think about the teacher sent from God. I'll splice all these clips together and hopefully we'll get one message out of it. The Lord bless you.